This show is brought to you by Slice on Broadway, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza, sliceonbroadway.com. And listeners like you, support this show at patreon.com/awesomecast. It's the AwesomeCast episode 300. I'm Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on the Twitter. Katie's playing with the mic over there. And we are in a Mayhem Studios here in Pittsburgh, PA, for the 300th edition of this. On the eve, the year eve of 6 years of AwesomeCast, we'll be celebrating that next week. But here for the big 300 in the studio, we got the crew. We got the awesome regulars, awesome co-hosts here. First of all, Katie Dudas at K Dudders on the Twitter and also on the where are you on the Snapchats?
Since
you're snapping more.
I'm Dudzy. I really need to change it.
Dudzy.
D-U-D-Z-Y. Yeah, because see, this is what happens when you're like, I'm going to try something and not let people know that I'm something and use some
also,
sort of incognito.
Apologies, you are apparently at Cutters on your screen. I'll try to fix that here. At Cutters on the Twitter.
Ooh, let's see who that actually is. Go
ahead. Yeah, they're about to get some new friends. We'll fix that there. And also with us, of course, she's the director of. You do a lot of fun stuff at the Scare House, basically.
I'm awesome.
And also with us, he's the gadget guru over at the big ass bank here in Pittsburgh, John Chichilla, chillatech.net.
Back in Studio A. It's been too long.
It has been too long. I know we've screwed you up so much these last few weeks.
Oh, that's all good.
First I go to San Diego, then you're...
First it was the girl show.
First it was
the
girl show. It was like, I'm sorry, Chilla, there's no room for you on the arc. But anyways, this is the AwesomeCast. We get geeky, talk tech, have some fun here for people in Pittsburgh talking about stuff. And hey, a shout out. We have some new awesome chats coming up from some of the winners of Startup Weekend Women's Edition. So please go check that out. Subscribe to the Awesome Chat on all the places. But of course, subscribe to the AwesomeCast, theawesomecast.net, iTunes, Stitcher, Spreaker, iHeartRadio, Google Play Podcasts, YouTube, and the Facebook. We're actually Facebook Living it up right now as well, so you can check that out or join us at live.sorgatronmedia.com for that chat room where everybody's interacting, including Wheels is hanging out with us right now and a couple other people. I'm presuming Claudia and Hugh are you two, right?
I'm not. Yeah, I forgot to jump in there.
Yeah, all right. Oh, so somebody might
you?
Be a real person. Ooh. Look at that. But anyways, we have a lot of fun here. So everybody, what is your awesome thing? Oh, wait. Oh, I almost forgot something. Patreon. Thank you to our Patreon people. Thistle Seed Business Development up in Cranberry Township, as well as the Mike Fedor Show at Mike Fedor Show on the Twitters. Thank you so much. There are executive producers been supporting the show for a good while here at the $5 level, and you can too at patreon.com/awesomecast. And also you can check us out. We're over on riversedgepgh.com every Thursday 8 a.m. after Funny Money. Great music all the rest of the time, and a lot of great shows coming up there as well. Now let's talk about our awesome things of the week. Before we get all googly here, Katie, what's going on?
I'm googly.
You're googly?
I was googly.
I guess it is. Yes.
Yes, I am googly.
Before we get very Google IOE, I guess.
Okay. This is just surface googly. Today I went to the Pittsburgh Business Times, had a social or a digital marketing for small business event down at Duquesne Club, their bathrooms are very fancy. They have real towels, like,
as you would know if you followed her on
cloth towels,
like Snapchat. Cloth towels, like there's stacks of them. No, stacks of cloth towels.
Wow.
And they have a camper, so you're like bleep, 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 boop. And there's a desk in the bathroom. I wrote some correspondence to my friends and family. Greetings.
Is there Wi-Fi?
Don't know.
Can you bring your laptop in there?
Oh my gosh, it's a turn to work. I'm gonna put coffee and work there. We should do that. What if anybody would kick us out? So I went to this event and we had somebody from Google there, which is always, you know what, no matter what presentation I go to, as long as it has somebody from Google, they have something to teach me, because there are so many things that I will never, you know, ever figure out. Google sales strategy enablement Jesse. She was awesome. And what we were talking about a lot of it is digital media is so much of it is mobile, and people essentially are not always buying on mobile, but they're doing all their research beforehand on mobile. And then they're either going to a desktop or in person to actually make the purchases. So a lot of times people are like, well, I don't want to spend money on mobile because it's not resulting in purchases. But it is, in a way. It just, there's no good way to track that at this point. So something I didn't even realize was an option is Google Mobile Friendly Tool. And if you go to that, it's a webmaster tool. You actually put it in your website, your URL, and it will tell you whether you're mobile friendly.
Analyzing SorgatronMedia.com right now.
ChillaTech.net is 100% mobile friendly.
Nice. Sorgatron.com is as well. And I'm sorry, I should have just stuck around on that, but it's it's analyzing. It's taking a good time with it, but
it does surprise me how long it does take to run. Mm-hmm. It must be doing some in-depth.
Awesome. This page is mobile friendly and talks a little bit about how Googlebot sees the page, and you see what it looks like there. Now, mobile friendly does not mean that it's entire, like, you know, you look at, I can't even see that in there. But if you look at like SorgatronMedia.com, there's a giant logo that, and then you don't know what to do after that. Right. So designing around mobile is, I think, a different thing too. Right.
Yeah. You know, it's not necessarily, that it's optimized. Let's use that word mm-hmm. in a mobile format. But it may be able to work on mobile, because some websites, if you've ever been to it, there's no, you've gone to a website before, and I'm trying to think of one that I've been to lately where it was like, oh my gosh.
The old SorgatronMedia.com, for one, was not mobile friendly one bit.
I've seen ones where it's like the full, it's like a full page zoomed all the way out. So like the text is like this big and you have to pinch and zoom everywhere.
Yep.
Always painful.
And that was the biggest thing when I would go into a client and it'd be like, you need a new website. And like, but we just designed it 5 years ago. It's like, yeah, we have cell phones now and that doesn't work here. Plus you have cell some phones. Flash. So. And that's where Squarespace is nice because it's all the designs are already like kind of set for it. Right.
Yeah. There's, you figure between mobile and tablets and everywhere else, we're looking at things you have to have it mobile optimized. And it's nice because they have some things on there if you want to learn more about mobile friendly pages, like what makes it mobile friendly or why is this not working or why are people not doing things on my page. But it's nice because they show you a little snapshot of your website on there of what people would see, which is also cool.
I guess for people that don't have cell phones, I mean, well, the other thing is like go pull out a cell phone and see what it looks like. But again, not everybody, I guess, has that going on, right?
Or thinks about it. I mean, if you're you know, new to digital media and you're like, oh, I have a website. It's so cool. Check it out. And you just check it on your laptop. I mean, even professionals, how many times I've done things where I'm like, oh, between my laptop and my phone, I've looked at images and go, oh, that color is wrong. They're like, did you look at it on your desktop? I'm like, no.
Or, well, it used to be when I was first learning web design, it was check every browser, check Mac, check, you know, you had to check every browser. Then you had to check every browser on Mac versus PC. Now it's, you know, Dreamweaver. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm invoking Dreamweaver here.
Yes.
Had a mode for resolutions, because then you also had to say, well, what does this look like on this size screen versus this size screen, right?
Chrome has that, and Chrome will let you do agent. It'll let you spoof agents too to make it look
we
like
didn't
you're
have those kinds of fancy
browser.
Tools back in the day when we were hand coding our HTML. and this is kind of the new side of it. I can't believe how ahead of the curve we were in like 2004 when we were designing Flash applications for a Trio. I think that's really good because this is a big component to your Google ranking anymore, right?
Mm-hmm. When it's interesting, they do a really nice job about the Webmaster's Mobile Guide and Principles of Site Design, and then even the how to let the Googlebot view the page correctly. This is well done. This isn't just like a Joe Schmo, hey, your website passed this little test. It's click here and also learn more.
And it's not overly technical. Like if you've ever used a W3C validator, it's kind of rough. We would put when I was teaching at PTI, that's how we tested the kid's code. You know, we're like throw it through the validator and see what pops up. But then you had to kind of parse what it meant and try to narrow it down and everything, you know. But again, that's code versus, hey, is this compatible, you know, mm-hmm. kind of thing. But I'm sure if you get into like a little bit of the mobile guide, I'll actually open these up a little bit and see what they look like. I'm sure they get pretty technical as you dig in. So good. And that kind of goes into the whole other, did they talk about, I can't remember what's called now. What is the, I hear about it every week on This Week in Google. The format, so like articles will pop up on Google search. Do they talk about that at all?
No.
It's kind of like live. It's kind of like Facebook's instant articles, mm-hmm. but for Google. Actually, through plugins on like AwesomeCast.net and everything to maybe help out. You know, I don't know how well it helps or anything like that. But I think that also kind of scores you to pop up to the top of the rankings as well. Anything like that that makes the experience better. They will, much like Facebook, like they want people to stick around. Right.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah. And a lot of these, like we said, are free tools that are out there. If you're getting into this and just learning about digital marketing and you want to know what I need to do for certain things or how do I get myself in Google searches, there you go. Google is giving you the answers if you're willing to look.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. They just don't like it when you game it. Just play by the rules.
Yeah, and everybody's happy.
And you'll be okay. So go check that out. That's what's the probably just looking up mobile friendly test Google.
Mm-hmm.
Googling it.
Yeah, just go into Google and Google this and yes. you'll Google.
Yep. All right, Chilla, what's your awesome thing of the week?
So I got a little googly about out of IO.
There's a lot to get googly.
There's
about
a lot
this
to get
week.
Yeah, there is a lot to get googly. And mine was a toss up, but their video chat app duo. Mm-hmm. It was pretty impressive. And I really liked the little kind of knock-knock where you got to see not only who was calling, but their live video feed as they were calling. At first I thought it was kind of gimmicky, but then I'm like, that's actually really nice. Because if I see someone in a business setting that pings me in that manner, I'll probably be more apt to pick up. And depending on the setting that person's in, that will help in deciding if I'm going to pick up. Because that's one thing that I will say, and what I'm interested in is, how is this going to work if you don't have can you use it without a Gmail account? Am I going to get weird video chat requests like I do junk mail sooner or later?
I haven't seen an article without the word penis in it, for instance.
You have what?
Everybody's like, everybody thinks that it's going to be like Snapchat where people are going to just be sending loose pictures as the knock knock. But you can block people, I'm sure. Like, there'll be more of that going on.
But like right now, I look at my cell phone and the number of calls I get that are just phone numbers that I have no clue who it is.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Like, if they started using this and it was a person in a professional type setting,
mm-hmm.
I may be apt to pick up the phone,
mm-hmm.
even if I don't know who you are.
Or the telemarketer is going to like swerve you and you know, you know.
I really like the concept. I think it's the other thing that really surprised me about. I thought it was hysterical that the guy hung up on his kids like very abruptly in the demo. If you saw the demo, quite funny, but the ability to see the person calling, I could see this being pretty cool. And the other thing that surprised me is in this presentation and every presentation they did, they commented on the and will be simultaneously released on iOS and Android.
Yes.
That was definitely something that kind of caught me off guard. I figured we'd be seeing a lot of this stuff for Android first and iOS later.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't say Windows Phone, but that's okay. For me anyway. But I think it's a cool concept. I'm looking forward to using this.
Mm.
And I'm looking to see how much I can get other people to start using it.
Well, here's the other thing is adoption, right? Because mm-hmm. this as well as Allo, are not new features of Hangouts or anything that you're already using. We're going to have to use one more thing.
Mm-hmm.
just one more thing that I have to, oh, use this over here, you know, versus, you know, even today, like I did a Skype call and I did Google Hangouts, you know, and it's like, well, okay, what works for you? It's like, oh, I was sitting there trying to install Skype on three machines because I realized nothing in front of me had Skype on it. And like, I'm like, whichever wins, let's see where this goes. You know, like, but again, it's that adoption. You accept that because everybody's using Skype. Mm-hmm. You have to start over with this now. Hey, I'm going to give you a call. Do you have Duo on your phone? You know, or mm-hmm. is there something where, especially probably on Android, if you maybe there'll be a little hook. Actually, you know, the answer is right in front of us, isn't it? Because there's the part where apps are going to preload or partial load as needed. Mm-hmm. So you could do a Duo call with a little button in Hangout and it'll just download that part that gets you started, isn't it? That's it is going to be its own app, right?
Well, and I don't think I've heard a lot of question of, is this going to get rid of Hangout? I think Hangout's going to be your multi-person type interface with desktop screen sharing this and all the FaceTime. Additional stuff. This is FaceTime.
This mm-hmm. is definitely FaceTime. So it's interesting. No, and again, it's not something like what we use because we use Hangout as kind of a Skype-ish thing for multi-person video interview, you know, stuff in a podcast setting. Plus, it has its hooks into YouTube. This is purely going to be person to person. And I can't remember from the discussion, is there encryption involved in this as well with the calls? I know Allo, there was a discussion.
I think there is encryption end to end.
Okay. So there's that too.
And I think this is going to be a good gateway to the moms and dads and aunts and uncles.
That's what FaceTime. Yeah. I was amazed when a client was like, I'll FaceTime you. I'm like, mm-hmm. what? Really? Okay.
I think this is going to be the gateway into Hangouts.
Yeah.
So I think this is going to be the conversation that you call the kid and with your computer problem, right? And they're like, okay, let's get into a Hangout and you're going to share your desktop now.
Well, and it's also FaceTime for the rest of us, mm-hmm. like FaceTime for the non-Apple people. Like I can now quote FaceTime, although I could kind of do it now with Hangouts, but it's still like, you know, I know my Android friend will have Hangouts on there because mm-hmm. I think it's pretty much standard at this point, right?
I think
so. Like I feel like we're kind of duplicating a feature a little bit, and I know there's the hook of the knock knock and everything like that, but I want to see what more it's going to offer beyond that than what. Love the idea, but it feels kind of gimmicky. Mm-hmm. You know, oh look, you can see the person. Like, what? Why can't we just have that on Hangouts? You know, it just the feature doesn't beget a new app, and I just think that's just a little bit odd.
The one question I had too was they don't have an audio only version, do they? Or is there a way to do this without sending?
Well, it's described video. As a one-to-one video calling app. So
and this is where I think like FaceTime audio comes in big. That if you can't get your cellular connection, or you need to call someone, and you're without phone and you can grab an iPad or a Mac or whatever.
Which is, I've used it.
I think the voice piece of that is big. So I would Google, if you're listening, if you want to get even more googly, I don't think we need an additional app.
Or is this all going to mesh together? Because really Google Voice is kind of in Hangouts, but it's still mm-hmm. my Google Voice number. But that's the thing I use when I'm up at the one office where I don't have cell service mm-hmm. and I get on the Wi-Fi and make my business calls or ask them to call there. You know, is it just all going to be called a different thing, but it's all going to intermesh? Hopefully. Right.
I would hope so.
So. We'll talk about Allo and everything in a little bit. And like I said, this is going to be very Google I/O, I think, heavy on announcements, since we did have a lot come out of there, and definitely worth talking about. But my big thing is Daydream. That's right. Daydream. It's Google's Android-powered VR platform. So, you know, the rumors, you know, going into this was, oh, they're going to announce something big. It's going to be the next step of Cardboard. It'll be their own headset. And then everything was kind of mostly right. So the idea is, this looks like just an extension of the Samsung Gear VR that Chilla has had in here before, as we would poke at each other blindly. But the idea that it's a a better headset, more than just a piece of cardboard, which the Velcro just came off of my cardboard today. So I need a new cardboard or glue, I guess, when I was playing with stuff. But, you know, something a little more to it and better sensors and everything. But expanded out that you don't need just a Samsung phone, but there will be a spec. Apparently a 4K phone will be needed or one of the specs for this. I can't recall, but I know that was one of the things that they were talking about. But basically they're going to have a spec that there'll be, like, you know, some enabled phones for this, and they're going to have a headset for it. They're going to have partners including Samsung, HTC, LG, Xiaomi, Huawei, ZTE, Asus, and Alcatel. You see, those Daily Tech News shows taught me how to say those middle words, by the way. Thank you so much to those guys. And it's got a controller too, with a, you know, has it kind of seems like the Apple TV controller, where it has a gyroscopic accelerometer and all that kind of stuff, and a couple buttons. So there's a little more than just, you know, a little more than what Gear VR does, right? Because it's basically just a button or a touchpad, right?
There's the touchpad and the back button.
Yeah, so you have a little bit more. So you can,
now you'll have, but you can use a Bluetooth controller.
Okay.
With that.
Okay.
But it is a lot of look somewhere and tap
right
on your head.
Right, and that's really what cardboard has been mostly as well.
No, stop it! I'm just selecting things. I'm selecting things. That's not what I want to look at.
But that is the most confusing thing. So I'm interested in how they built that remote.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, if it gets flipped around in your, it looked like if it got flipped around in your hand, it could get confusing as to what end is up, because it looked kind of symmetrical.
Right.
In one of the, I didn't see it in the live stream, but I saw it after, like a picture after the fact.
Yeah.
So I think that's going to be key for them. And then I don't know, it'll be interesting to see how they conquer that UI user interface, user experience side of it.
Right. It could be just as simple as like the home keys. Like there could be a home mark on it that says, oh, this is the top, switch it the other way. Or maybe it doesn't matter in the long run, you know, depending on how they set it up.
There'll be one button to roll them all.
One button to roll them all, just like the old Apple mouse that we can't. You still have to turn that other mouse button on when you have to get a Mac. Why? Why? But I'm excited for this because, again, I really think, like, this, again, you're going to have to get a nice phone. You're going to get a specific phone. And from the sounds of it, not initially, but the iPhone will be a compatible phone, will be a certified phone. It has the horsepower. They just need to have the apps for it. And I think that's probably going to be the only delay in this, right? And aside from that, also probably giving a little headway to all the phones coming out at the end of the year that are qualifying for this. But this is that cordless, not needing a $2,000 computer, you know, idea that I think is really actually going to take off virtual reality in the long run. Because you know, it needs to be accessible. And the more that you have opportunities like this, I think it's going to be very helpful to the whole trend going on, or fad, whatever you want to call it. Or 360 video. Oh, we didn't even talk about that. We're going to talk about the thing in the studio that's staring us in the face after the break, I think.
This floating orb.
But we'll touch that in a moment. Sorry, it's just been staring at me. I forgot that was all before the show. But no, I think Daydream is a very interesting move from that. And you know, cardboard, I don't think is going away. I think cardboard is still the cheaper school option, like a Chrome OS, you know, like a Chromebook. But no, looking forward to that as far as more 360 and VR options. So, well, guys, you know, what you can't experience in VR very well, at least as of yet, is Slice on Broadway. Our good friends have been supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with pepperoni pizza for a good while now, with their home at PNC Park, home of the Pittsburgh Pirates, when they're not getting rain delayed like our good friends were experiencing this weekend. But anyways, go check them out. Our friends here in Beachview along the tracks. I think they're still gone. I don't know. I haven't been up top of the hill for a week. Slice on Broadway here in Beachview, of course, the main street down in Carnegie, PA, and as like I said, PNC Park. So go check them out. Rico and the guys supporting us here every week on the Awesome Cast and Podcast Day. They're local. They're awesome. They just got announced as another top pizza. I think it was it next Pittsburgh? I think I saw that article.
Oh, very cool.
Once again, recognized. And there are plenty in this area that get recognized for pizza. Like, there's like three of them, like, within a mile of my house. But this is the one I select more often than not. It is the number one pick. And it should be yours too. Go check them out. SliceOnBroadway.com. PJH_Slice on Twitter. And they're on Facebook and Instagram too. Let them know the awesome cast sent you. So, Chilla.
Chilla. What's up?
What's looking at me right now?
What is looking at you? I don't know. What's
looking at
it's
me
like
right
now? It's like an orb floating in the middle of the air.
It's an orb looking at in the air. There is going to be a 360 version of this episode, apparently, if everything works out.
If everything works out, yeah. The red light's blinking, so it's doing something.
We talked about this 2 weeks ago. Last week. That was last week.
Mm-hmm.
You got the Gear VR 360.
The Gear 360.
Gear 360.
Which is the double-sided camera to record video and photos and whatnot. And if you hit the second link... Obviously, the first link goes to the product. The second link, if you go to that second link in the doc, it goes to a quick blog that I wrote, and you scroll down on that, scroll about half, three quarters of the way down the page, you're going to see an image that I took at work. And you can actually click and drag, keep going down and down and down and right there, and see if you click and drag. No, don't make it full screen unless you really want to.
I really want to.
So you can click and drag around the room.
This doesn't look real. This just doesn't look real.
So that's a real picture in one of our areas of our offices. You can see I'm using Panelum on that. So if you go over to that TV and you click on it, it tells you mm-hmm. what the TV is.
And we discussed Panelum last week as well.
So I've been playing around with this a lot. That my next step is to take a foray into video, which we're kind of starting off today. The interesting thing, and I found one player. I'm trying to find more players that will allow me, like you're doing, like it's showing here, where it's a some code that allows me to put this with no plugins and no mm-hmm. nothing special. I need the same thing for video because I can't upload things to Facebook and whatnot. So anybody, if you're out there, I'm looking at I think it's Valiant 360. Is one of the video players.
Mm-hmm.
It's on GitHub as well, so it's free and open source and pluginless.
I am so sorry. I'm picking at this right now, but I am noticing the seam.
Yeah, there is a seam.
There's definitely a seam. If you're on audio, you have no idea. Video, you might have to blow this up or go to chillatech.net and you can see it yourself at full screen. But there, because what it is. You know, and you see just a little bit of goofiness. And to be fair, I was looking at the New York Times videos, and they have the same issue. Mm-hmm. And I think they may have been recording on like a Ricoh Theater or something earlier or something like this. Or something like this that's like the ball in two cameras instead of like multiple ones, mm-hmm. right? And actually, I think we can lead this, and after this, I'll talk about a discussion that I had today as well with some 360 people. I think, Chilla, you'll be interested in. But you know, it is two cameras, and yeah, it's catching a wide breadth, but it does need to connect them.
Yeah, it does. Yeah, and it also, you'll notice in their app, when you go to view a picture or whatnot, or I'm sure it'll be the same when you go to view a video.
Mm-hmm.
It actually, there's a progress bar and it stitches it. It's pretty cool. Right in the viewer, you can actually set it to be where you can actually take your phone and kind of move around in a circle like you took some pictures on Facebook and whatnot using the 360 stuff.
Yeah.
You can do the same thing where I can kind of tilt up and look around as if I'm looking in that room where the picture was taken. So pretty cool.
I love all this. I want one.
I mean, even for most things, I don't think a lot of people are going to notice the seam, especially if it's something like you're trying to buy a house or looking for an apartment rental.
Right.
I'm surprised that Airbnb could definitely be using this type of technology. The scare house, because
I can.
I'm
looking at, like, for what is this, Panelum? Am I pronouncing it right? And I'm looking at the info buttons, and we could just put this in a room and this be like, this process took blah, 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 blah. This mm-hmm. is actually an antique piano from blah. I'm like, oh, I'm just.
So you can also make these links.
Oh, really?
Where it'll give you the information and it works as a link to get you to another page, so you can take it to a video or something. And then if you see that, that actually takes you into the next room. So it's pretty cool.
So you can kind of create your own kind of street view kind of that's situation amazing. There.
And
without...
this, the 360 is not very expensive.
No.
Oh my gosh.
No.
And it's dirt and I was looking at, sorry, I'm taking dirt? It's dirt and dust resistant and I'm so excited.
But I'm very curious to see, again, what does the video look like? Because I think that's where the sacrifice is going to be, is when it takes that, like from my scene from Rico Theta footage, that's where it, you know, kind of usually. So I want to see how this compares to that. Mm-hmm. So,
well, and don't forget, like the Gear VR viewer, mm-hmm. you're only talking 480p. Screen resolution.
Okay.
So even if that shoots double or triple,
so the idea
you're still going to have to downscale to get onto a consumer grade equipment.
Right. So, well, but you got to think, like, you're seeing, you know, X amount wide and you're seeing that tiny bit. Is that at least 480? You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, you know.
So here's what I can tell you. When I did the photo, the photo came out at like 29 megapixel. And to put it on anything, I had to downsize it instantly to 25 megapixel. That's great.
And then when
I had to make it where a mobile browser, because now you talk about you got to test across your browsers, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Mobile browsers, the max resolution is like, I had to cut it in half.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
So I had to cut it in half again. So I'm not hitting the ceiling on the device from a photo perspective. It'll be, to your point, it'll be interesting to see what I hit from a video perspective, but from a photo perspective, I'm already having to scale it back in quality so the devices and browsers can handle it, let alone the fact that the file size.
And again, not everything needs to go into a 360 thing, but this is really, Samsung made this thing to make content for their other thing, the Gear VR, right? Like they've created their own ecosystem. And the other thing with this, like it may do better in certain aspects because I think some of the number crunching isn't happening on the camera anymore. It's happening on the phone. It's happening when you offload it. Mm-hmm. It's not, it doesn't need all the processing power basically in-house to work on that. So maybe, you know, this, and how much is this when it retails?
$399.
Something, I think it was Amazon, it was like $391 or something.
Right, which is roughly comparable to Rico Theta. So I want to see what it compares to that as well.
I heard someone was saying the Rico Theta, though, can crop you out of the picture if you're holding it.
Ooh.
Someone was telling me that at work. I'm like, really? How does that work?
Yeah, it might be
361,
something.
I'm sorry. Where'd it go? I just had it for 361, now it's gone. We'll find it.
And I don't think the U.S. price has been 100% announced yet, so...
Yeah,
I think it's still, that may end up being $299.
So,
because I'm curious to see what
or $399.
The video looks like on YouTube.
Right, yeah, yeah, that's what I want. It's gonna be a big test,
and we'll work on Facebook 360.
Well, I guess it goes back to like we were talking about earlier with iTunes and whatnot. How are you consuming that information? Because if you're consuming it on your phone, you're not gonna want to push a four time. You're not gonna want to push 4K, right?
Right. Right.
If you're trying to push it to a 4K large TV, 70-inch TV, okay, I could see why you would want it to be large. But then I feel like if you're pushing it to something that big, you're losing the interactive portion of it.
What's this?
Remember how we were discussing the Google Street View? This is compatible with the Google Street View, so you could add your business
there
to the 360 on the maps.
There you go. Well, if the studio thing works out, we're definitely putting ours in there.
Sorry, I just was like,
that's awesome.
So I think you're going to, I think at least from a consumer or even prosumer, you're going to be hit for a while. At least you're with these types of devices, you're going to be hitting the ceiling.
Mm-hmm. And what the devices can do
of what the devices, can
like
do.
What the viewers can do. Right.
Right. I think this is where I like competition like this, because this is going to push every manufacturer of devices to push their devices further to be able to handle stuff like this.
Mm-hmm.
I was impressed on the Samsung Galaxy S6, and I have the newer Note. The stitching, at least from the photo stitching perspective, I would say on the S6, it's like 2 seconds, and on the Note, it's sub-second to stitch the photo together and get everything rolling, even to grab the photos off of Bluetooth, because it's all Bluetooth file transfer. Worked pretty well. You can plug it in, you can remove the SD card. There's local and SD card storage, but pretty cool.
Well, while you're doing that, as we discussed, spent a few days in the desert. And while I was out there, I was using that Splash program that we discussed previously.
See, I love this. And
you dig this.
You seem like
you got the fancy toy.
You're quasi against it. And I'm like, this is awesome. I feel like I'm with you.
For me. What? I said, I feel like you're with me. You're with me in the middle of the desert. There's a mountain over there. There's all this. Actually, this worked out really well. This is actually at Baja SAE SoCal. That's all the tents and the paddocks and everything in the distance there. And I'm in the middle of the track. And there's actually an active track you can kind of see. And again, I kind of have that resolution issue that you were talking about over in the distance here, right? And we talked about this in the past. So it's you're basically taking your iPhone and it kind of follows you around, kind of like when you're doing pano on iOS. Now go over here, and you're taking multiple pictures. I actually had a discussion with Yuri this morning from Splash, because they've been doing this really interesting thing with a closed group with super splashers, and a bunch of people have been posting on there. And if I find the right thing, so about kind of like, you know, what they wanted some feedback, and they kind of wanted to get an idea. To me, still the weird thing is, do you really need to make me like have at least one video frame? Because it never works out for me. Mm-hmm. And also figuring out a little bit, because as you look at these, you'll notice there's a lot of, we talked about seams with the gear. Like, this is a very kind of, I don't want to say ham-fisted way of doing it, but it is. It's like you just have your phone. You don't have a thing. You're doing it basically the hard way. I'm sitting there, you know, in the middle of the desert or the middle of like a tourist thing. I actually have one up here. I did have the Bob Hope USO dedication in San Diego. And again, everything was very close, so I was trying to be very careful with that, right? And you know, talking with them, they talked about how this was should be, you know, they're looking at it as like a Snapchat for 360 video. And again, you're seeing some of these, and some people doing very interesting things where, you know, there are multiple points where there is interaction, or they're having fun with these where I don't know if it was on here, but there's one where they're doing dancing, and they would have like layers of the same person dancing in different spots in the room. Like, that's cool. At the same time, you can play with that a little bit. The other thing that I discussed with them, and they were actually already on this. So I used to do way back in like 2001, 2002. I had a class in QuickTime VR.
Wow.
I think it was a photography class. Uh-huh. Finally, in one of those segments was in. And you had to have a special tripod, right, that spun the camera in such a way that the camera was like the lens that was basically in the same place. So you didn't get the seams and everything would work, and you would, you know, twist it the same way. They're actually starting to actually educate their users on this, because I realized that in that last one I was showing you in the desert, that one I was out there with my video tripod and I stuck the camera on it. I stuck my phone, you know, just held it on top of it and spun and took the pictures. Not perfect by any means, but still a better result. And that's what they're saying. You actually need to spin around your camera instead of, you know, holding it out and spinning and pivoting yourself, you know. And I think that's, you know, that I mean, that's why, you know, this camera here works, because it's got two cameras at the right angle and they're both at the right point, and they you know, the math is done for you basically, whereas we're really kind of making up as we go here.
See, the one thing and where I said, you know, I feel like I'm with you, I feel like when you have this in a room, even with the tripod, I have a longer delay set, because this will work in standalone mode too. You don't need a phone with you at all times to be able to take a photo or do a video or anything like that. But I have the delay pumped all the way up to like 15 seconds because I feel awkward being in the picture. So I'm constantly putting it in a room, hitting the button, and then running out.
That's why I see what you're doing. So this, I'm behind the camera.
You're behind all the time. Camera, and I don't see you.
Right. So it's always going to be. Here's another one. I was up on one of the hills up here, and again, I had that little bit of weird video thing that just pops up in the middle, and I'm hoping that's something they smooth over kind of as they go here. But I guess you don't see me because I'm behind the camera all the time.
Right.
So
But to me, there's almost a comfort factor with then wanting to make these, because you don't have, to me, the awkward, I don't want to put myself in the picture. Mm-hmm. Whereas with these types of devices, you have to either delay it or record for a little bit and then get out of the frame before you know what I mean? And then
crop
use that
later and everything. Later.
Like there's something to be said for the way both of them work, and there's pros and cons. Mm-hmm. But the one thing someone was saying with one of them, you can hold it out in front of you, and it's supposed to be able to, if it has enough information for what's behind you, it can crop you out. Not from a video perspective, but at least from a photo perspective. So I thought that was pretty neat.
Yeah. So, I mean, there's a lot of options out there. There's a YouTube for Splash. You can check out what a lot of people are doing there. I thought it was in this group, but I found it somewhere when I was talking with them today. But there's actually a new... they have a new version coming soon that's going to have a lot of new features, a lot about community and sharing. And it was interesting. Apparently, there's a hack that they've been sharing with everybody to, like, if you're a business page. So let's say Scarehouse wanted to do this and they just wanted to use Splash instead of getting a camera or something. Mm-hmm. You can't share directly to a business page, but you can share it to the YouTube, which all goes to, I think, their YouTube, which is a little odd. But you can actually download it from YouTube, as you can do, and mm-hmm. and upload it with the code to your business page, and then you have your 360 thing on your business page. So it was a little hack they worked around so businesses can start taking advantage of this as well. So and again, it's a nice accessible thing, a small business with no budget to drop, you know, $400 on this or even more at the prosumer versions we're looking at, you know, and just boom, there you go, you have it. Mm-hmm. You know, so I think that's a pretty cool way to do that. And again, it's not perfect by any means. It might get perfecter.
More perfect?
As we get more perfect-ish. Now, okay, here's
it's
one
a,
thing.
It's a roadmap to perfection.
I actually didn't get to check this out in a browser to see exactly how it went. This is the one I did with the Bob Hope thing in San Diego. So I dropped the video in the center where he is, and I'm hoping, and again, I didn't go to make sure, but there's audio playing of him telling jokes at a USO thing. And I'm hoping that plays in the background here. I can't tell on this computer here. And they have these kind of statues of people watching them, and they got a little weird too. That guy's torso is missing. You know, and I thought I was like so careful with this, and it looked right in my preview, and then I got this, you know. But still kind of generally an interesting feature, right?
Mm-hmm.
But it's Splash. It's and I believe they're in Germany. So that was fun. Hopefully they get a longer discussion. Hopefully get them on Awesome Chat here in the next couple weeks as well. So as we're going 360, as we're looking to the future, and as you're checking out chillatech.net to see what he's doing in the future.
Chilla's what the future already brings.
In his future building with his future camera.
He's already in the future. He just travels back for the show.
Yeah, I'm glad he visits us.
You know. You're like the little green guy on the Flintstones. What was this?
Yeah, you're our great kazoo.
That's it.
I don't even remember that.
Great.
I'll have to look up that reference.
You're our great chill zoo.
Yes.
Sure.
He comes back and teaches us about the future.
Yes, let us know. Let us know how the future goes. Google, of course, announced, as we already got into a little bit of the future-ish stuff. So let's touch on a little bit more what's going on here. Chilla, since you're the Google follower more probably than either of us, what's the next awesome thing on here?
So I'm gonna go out on a limb, and I'm sure there's people that are gonna disagree with me, but home. So, and I think, and why I'm saying home is because they haven't announced a price point. If they can come in under Echo, I think everyone's going to want one of these things. So Google Home is Google's version or take on the Echo from a home assistant perspective.
By the way, at that point, you woke up Cortana on this Windows 10 machine.
Sorry.
Which is another reason why I don't want to put Windows 10 on my studio machine.
Well, you can make it where that you can turn that. That's off by default.
Features.
features. Oh, but why'd she wake up? Because I said Echo.
I don't know. It didn't. Home. It liked something you said.
Hey there,
thanks, Cortana.
Hey, Cortana. See, and now that didn't wake her up.
It's Chilla's voice.
She's coded to me.
Yeah.
Chilla is the future.
In the future, I've programmed her.
That's like my dog owner only responding to the person visiting, you know, instead of me, you know.
I felt like for the first time, Google got their video right. Ooh. When they showed the commercial for this.
Okay.
They got it right.
I'm not sure if I
saw it. Was a real world use case. It was a family getting ready for the day. It was someone getting ready to go to work. It was someone getting ready for their flight.
Pictures of this device are not terribly captivating.
Right.
We're like, what is this Febreze thing going on here?
But the ability to, and where I think they really got it was with the kids. Mm-hmm. For a kid to say, I think the question was something about the Milky Way, and the home device responded. And then the kid said, can you show me that on the TV? And it came up instantly on the Chromecast.
Oh, that's cool.
I like that.
So I thought that was really cool. And then at the end of, so then you have this family going out for the day and the kid has a school project and he's dressed up in a spacesuit. And he opens back up the door and says goodbye, like to Google Home. So I thought it really kind of showed the humanity and the human side of Google. A little less AI.
That sounds like an Apple thing
to
me.
It was very Apple-esque. And that's where I say they did a really good job of showing you how to use it and why you would use it and everywhere you would use it. Mm-hmm. What I'm interested in is, how does it know me from you? Like, are we all going to share an email address where it's going to use that kind of information, or is it going to,
and Google Apps people are screwed as always,
like how are we all going to share? And it hooks into audio and Chromecast and everything, so it's turn on this song up in this bedroom to wake up this kid, turn on the lights in this room to wake up this kid, it's check my flight, what's the traffic like on the way to work, and it's responding to everyone in the family.
See, I like that because this is something that my phone is already doing. All my Google apps are already doing this. I have a Google calendar already doing this. Mm-hmm. And cards, and we didn't talk about the Google Assistant, which apparently is going to be the replacement of sorts for cards. Like it's not like Echo that is, you know, kind of gathering, like, okay, I guess if you're in the Amazon ecosystem, that makes sense. But to get all that rest of that information for it to make sense, like, its context is different than this, right? I'm already living in a Google world, so it already knows everything it needs to know to help me be better, because they're already doing it in other less efficient ways, you could say.
And when I look at it from an Echo perspective, Echo already ties in with Nest, and it, which is a Google product, and it ties in with Wemo, and it ties in with everything else. Why can't Amazon just write into their stuff for Google Home? Wouldn't you want to be on every platform? Why put yourself on your own and your own only?
And I think that's their MO too, mm-hmm. because they have Kindles, but you can get Kindle everywhere. Right. So they have Echoes, but you can get an Alexa app everywhere now. Mm-hmm. So I don't think it's going to,
unless Google blocks them out of here, which I doubt they would.
No. Now, if we had the Siri obelisk, then they would, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that's going to start becoming a huge problem. I feel like WWDC needs to have you can write apps to talk to Siri.
And I think they've started to talk about that. And there was some music app that recently went that route where you could control it with voice and stuff.
Talk about Hound?
Yeah.
We've talked about Hound. We've talked about Viv, that are the back-end APIs, mm-hmm. right? But Siri has kind of been, as with everything with Apple, it's been a closed garden. But much like we have this app extensibility that's been really great and really taking off the last couple of years, Siri needs to show up to the party too.
And I think that
to compete with all this stuff.
I have a feeling she is going to show up to the party, and obviously
she'll be late. She'll be late. She'll be fashionably late,
but she'll be fashionable,
but she'll be fashionable or he.
And that's where I think bridging that gap to bring it to the desktop is the step in that direction.
Right. Right, exactly. I mean, you could get something, and it, like, this feels like it's going to be more open than, well, we'll talk to a little more than just your Chromecast, which then Google Cast is also popping up in TVs and everything too, mm-hmm. right?
Polaroid, I think, has one. Polaroid yeah. has like a $500 4K with built-in Chromecast.
Somebody was talking about on Cord Colors this week, like, oh, I have an old Sony or Samsung TV, or I think he said, and it had what the Miracast, which is what Google Cast is, Chromecast is built on, and they did a firmware update, and now it's compatible with all the Google stuff.
Awesome.
So, I mean, that's, you know, if it gets to that point where it's just everywhere, or it could just be something that maybe Apple just goes ahead and adds, you know, because it's a standard, you know, and they pretend that they like standards over there. You know, because the Apple TV stuff is nice, but I feel like it should be able to do more.
And so here's where I think that it's a double-edged sword, because you go to a location and you don't have, let's just say you have a vacation home with no internet, and all you want to do is throw up videos.
Or my Airbnb in Boyle Heights.
Or your Airbnb in Boyle Heights. And you just want to stream a movie that you have local on your phone.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You can't do that with your Chromecast.
Right.
You can do that with your Apple TV if you brought your Apple TV along.
Because it's like AirPlay.
Because you can do a direct connect over Ooh. Bluetooth.
Yeah.
So that's where I think there's a double-edged sword to Chromecast. Don't get me wrong. I'm starting to come around on the Chromecast train, but there's still a lot of things that direct connect. And that's actually something I've been looking at a lot with Miracast.
We need an updated map to things that Chilla is coming around on.
Miracast solves that issue, because Miracast is based on a direct connection.
Yeah.
Google kind of stepped in and standard made it their standard, where you have to connect to Google first to get the data, and then it gets
tossed over.
That's right,
because when you're throwing something in the Chromecast, it's talking to a server and kind of hands it off. Yeah, you're not streaming. When you do it the right way, when the Google thing is doing it the right way from like the YouTube app, you're not sending it from your phone. Really, the phone can turn off at that point, except to be a controller.
Right.
So, and that's why you lose that connection a lot.
So that's where for me, the next phase for Google is to figure out how to make it where you can cast direct. Mm-hmm. If I think that occurs, that they will win this war hand over fist from a casting and whatnot perspective,
let's
where
take
it works
that,
in both modes.
Let's take it around from the standards to, you know, a little bit of, you know, I feel like this goes partially hand in hand. Google Assistant and Allo. Jeez.
Not the green stuff that you put on your cuts and bruises.
How many L's are in Allo? I keep forgetting.
I guess two, isn't
it? But okay, first, Google Assistant. We talked about this is all that machine learning stuff that, you know, we have bots. I haven't even used a bot in Facebook Messenger yet. I kind of don't care to. I hear nothing but bad stuff. The other bot stuff that's going on, not in any kind of business that it feels like, you know, I could really kind of turn it around on. Like, I think you need a bigger business in order for that to make sense. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm a customer service for X, right? I don't know. Maybe we can figure out how bots can help Scarehouse customer service there this season. And give Katie a breather over there, right?
Be awesome. Just to you.
yeah. We just got to figure out a tree on that. Mm-hmm. But Google Assistant is, again, you know, we talked a little bit about how Home could be delivering things that I'm already doing with cards and everything more efficiently. And it looks like this explanation was weird. Chilla, how did you interpret the kind of Google Assistant thing? Is this going to be something that's just going to be in the Google apps in the future, you think?
I think it's going to be in your kind of text app.
Okay.
That's how I envisioned it. Like, you're going to be able to, this is going to be a contact.
Right.
And you're going to be able to text.
Because their presentation
and
of it, like
email and
their presentation was very like, I don't understand where this is happening, what you're showing me.
I think it's happening. So I think this is going to be like, okay.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I think it's going to be like that, where you're going to say, yo, Allo, want to play chess, or
yeah.
hey, I want us to go to, the family wants to go to the movies tonight, which is one of the examples they used. Mm-hmm. And we're going to take the kids with us, and we're going to, and it keeps up with the conversation. I think it's going to be like a contact, and I think you're going to be able to email this contact, chat with this contact.
Right. But it seems like it's going to be a little bit everywhere. I think this they were more talking about the technology and the kind of the understanding. Like, this is the thing that Google Home will respond to you because it's mm-hmm. it's the way it handles requests. We should explain a little bit further for those that maybe didn't check out the I/O stuff. So the examples they were giving were like, you know, were like, hey, Google, I want to go to a restaurant. Okay, there's this. And then you'd say, yeah, book it for me. And it would open up, again, that kind of partial app download we were talking about before that's going to be a part of Android, which I think it already is partially, at least in beta. It will open up or download that little bit of open table and book it for you, right? Presumably, I'm sure you have to have an account and it's all set up with your credit card and everything, right? It's not just like, oh, it's the first time.
Google Wallet.
Or I guess Google Wallet, yeah. I guess that does make sense. So it is that, hey, go book me tickets to X, you know, and it just goes and does that. And it's your personal assistant, right? You know, more than what Siri is when I just say, hey, remind me to do something.
What I thought was interesting, and I think they played it really well on the let's go to the movies scenario, was I want to go to the movies, and then the assistant came back and said, based on your likes, we recommend these three movies. Mm-hmm. And then they said, everything was like not necessarily family friendly. So they said, no, we're going to bring the kids. So then it, mm-hmm. so then it knew to alter the movie selection to be kid friendly. It also knew at that point in time that they needed four movie tickets mm-hmm. and the time and for the times of the movies. Mm-hmm. So I thought it was really slick in the way that it read between the lines to then grab additional information and automatically increment the number of tickets and blah, 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 blah. So I think that's where the big differentiator is going to come in. The problem that I have is I don't live in a full Google world.
Mm-hmm.
So like my movies and music don't come from Google. Mm-hmm. I know a lot of Apple people that their stuff's all Amazon.
By the way, you're going to have the Apple version of this that does all but X, Y, and Z and Q and S and, you know.
So what'll be interesting is can Google start to tap into my receipts
mm-hmm.
based on purchases, because Apple kicks me a receipt right to my email every time mm-hmm. I buy something on iTunes. Amazon does the same. So are they going to start aggregating all of these outside purchases to then help with your likes and dislikes?
You know, and I feel like if this was Apple, they would be taking a 30% cut off of everything that went through it too. So, yeah. Interesting. So aside from that, we have Project Aura, which we've talked about, like an early version of that. It's like the modular phone, Watch 2.0. Complications are a thing on there. So your watch will become more complicated. Actually, complications are the like little, you know, info things on a real watch. That's what they call it.
Yeah, and 2.0, I felt like everything other than Watch 2.0 were leapfrogging everyone. I thought Watch 2.0 was kind of a catch up to what other people were already doing.
Mm-hmm.
To me, the big one was the Chrome OS.
Yes, update. Android on the Chrome OS is definitely coming.
So, and I think that's going to be a big differentiator for that, right? So if I buy an app
mm-hmm.
on my Android device, it's going to run on my Chrome OS device. I also put a link in the notes too, that they've already started to list all the Chromebooks that are going to be able to handle that.
Because it's like kind of an emulator, right? So it's going to take a little more overhead. So
now what I'm interested in is because I'm sure it's an emulator and it's based on, you know, the capabilities of the Chrome OS devices. Obviously, all of our laptops and desktops are powerful enough to do that today. So when is Chrome going to get this? Is Chrome next in line to get the same capability?
Right. We'll see. All right, let's get out of the Google world for a moment. I'm sure. Bless you.
Thank you.
Google eat at the house. I want someone. Why didn't any of the technology say bless you? That's what I want. I want Google to do that.
All right.
You have to ask it to say it first.
Okay.
All right. Since they're so popular, we're going to have a couple clean stories, and then we'll get to the dirty one before we get out of here. Stories.
Can we do the dash one real quick?
I was actually on that line. So what's going on with this dash? Yeah, which is dash. The button, like, is the button that you can get, and I can get more Tide, for right. instance, right? Usually,
so it's like $5 from Amazon, and you can assign it to do something. You can assign it to order more of something. So you can put it next to your Tide in your laundry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and when you're running low on Tide, you hit the dash button.
Apparently, Trojan condoms next to your bed.
Yes. Charmin next to the toilet.
Yes.
Those are all $5, and they're $5 because they're obviously getting money back from you purchasing a bunch of stuff.
Yeah.
There's a new button. It's $20, and it's the Amazon Web Services Internet of Things button.
Oh, that's Ooh. Fancy.
And you can do anything you want with it. You can make it.
What?
Like you could code it to every time someone touches it, it retweets the last tweet in your feed.
Oh, so more than just Amazon things. It's just a button to do something.
It's like supposedly you're gonna be able to tie it into any web service.
So you can like if this then that you can do and it'll do something.
Right. So and it is gonna leverage Amazon Web Services, but that being said,
I could see
you could write an Amazon Web Service to do anything.
I could see you know, my new studio visions when we decide we're going to go live doing something, we say, hey, something's happened now. I'll just tweet that out.
Right.
We're like, hey, we're going live doing something.
I'd like to see it where in some of our more technical areas at work, you hit the button. It says someone's having a problem in this room.
No.
And then it dispatches help
mm-hmm.
to kind of be help on the way. So that's where I think it's pretty cool for $20. I ordered one just to play around with it. Unfortunately, I'm not going to get mine until August because that's Aww. When they'll be ready. But also eliminate the hassle of writing device specific code. Code in cloud to configure your buttons single, double, and long click, so it can do three different things.
Ooh.
You can actually have it track usage, initiate a call, send alerts, start up and stop a process, count items. I don't know. Pretty excited about this.
Awesome. Awesome. Cool.
That's neat.
I love it. Can you make your own labels for it? Is there a function for that that comes with it? Or is it just masking tape?
Not even masking tape. I'm sure you can get a sticker that'll go over it.
Yeah. Awesome. So yeah, that's cool. Katie, what's going on with Twitter?
Oh man, we're getting what they figured out. 24 new characters for Twitter.
Ooh.
Yeah, I know. That's what you could have before. Yeah, 24 characters at the end. Essentially, I really like this TechCrunch. They have a nice little infographic on their page. And they kind of have the how Twitter is how structure tweets today, and then the future tweet structure. The hidden prefix, the metadata, the at replies, like at so-and-so. So they're going to give you 13 characters before your tweet. 140 characters for your actual tweet, what's happening in your tweet, and then 20 up to 24 characters at the end for like the links in the metadata, if you attach a photo.
Okay, so does that mean if I put a link in the middle of my tweet, it won't
cut it off?
Okay,
do you know what I mean? Like it'll still count towards.
So I need to watch the formatting a little bit, because sometimes I'll put that link in the middle and put all my hashtags at the end.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. You gotta put your hashtags before the linky.
So yes, that's the official terms. You put hashtags before the linkies
mm-hmm.
to make your tweeties.
So wait, so go back to yeah, that sure. picture one more time.
Mm-hmm.
So that gives you more than 24, because it would give you.
We get 24 at the end.
That's and the you get 13 on the front end.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Well, that's 177.
Yeah.
Total.
Wow.
Whoa. That's exciting. And I like this because I like this as a good compromise to the let's let as many people have as many letters as they want. This will be awesome.
I don't want pages of a tweet.
Ever.
Like, I don't want a tweet to last multiple scrolls of the screen.
Yeah, you don't want people dropping entire blogs in the tweets like you have a Facebook. Right.
Yeah.
I mean, it works more or less on Facebook, or at least it's hidden in the right way. But like Twitter doesn't. It's micro blogging. Is this micro blogging
yes,
still? Like, are
still,
we still telling
still,
it that?
Still, yeah.
Yeah. Like Tumblr, I thought was micro blogging more. But I don't know. We were kind of talking about this beforehand, and I was like, yeah, okay, we'll see how long it takes for all the Twitter utilities I use to catch up. Mm-hmm. Although if they just update an API, it probably would be I don't know. We'll see.
It depends on who's doing the check.
Yeah.
So who's doing the validation of 140?
Yeah, is that something they check before rolling through, and we'll see. So
Twitter's making the announcement about the changes today to give developers time to prepare.
There you go. Get on that Hootsuite tweet jukebox and TweetDeck, which is actually Twitter, but still.
And also along with that, I don't know if you noticed, but if you use Snapchat, you can have two lines of text now.
Dun, dun, dun.
So no going fitting those little teeny words into
And stickers that follow you, apparently.
Yes.
I saw somebody like catching people on fire with theirs.
I like that idea.
All right. And of course, no, that was the other thing. All right, let's get dirty.
Get geeky.
Because these guys keep coming up with new ideas. And they are fantastic ideas. But Pornhub keeps in the news.
I love Pornhub.
Because Pornhub...
just for the show.
Pornhub I love Pornhub. Wants to help you get fit. Now, I can't show you the actual function of this because it's sponsored and powered by Brazzers, which is a term I had to take out of a wrestling DVD recently in commentary, by the way. So that was interesting. I'm glad we don't live stream. But no, and once again, if nothing else... the mostly work safe explanation videos are tremendous in this case. So basically they kind of said, well, we want to Guitar Hero porn, mm-hmm. basically. And these animations are amazing. And the idea is that you go and supposedly, I don't know if this is a real thing you can actually purchase from them, but there's something like bang.fit band, and you put your cell phone in the pocket on what's basically, I think, a belt, and that way you get the step count kind of situation
It's like the Wii. Whenever you had the thing that you put on your leg, whenever you were doing the running activities, and they kept track of how you were running.
Yep.
Because Fitbit and those
kind of... Can I show that?
We'll find out.
All right. We'll see what happens. It's a good thing we're audio on River's Edge.
Yeah. See, that's okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's things cartoons. Happening. Yeah. Because things like Fitbits and your wrists and your things do not... account for these kind of amorous activities.
Mm-hmm.
You get no steps.
No. No, and it's activity, and they're mm-hmm. trying to close the gap, as it were, with this. So, so you can check that out. It's much like the company's other initiatives, like the Wank Band, through its plan to film their first adult movie in zero gravity. Jeez, these guys are everywhere.
See, I mean, you're going to love Pornhub. I mean, they are pushing the limits.
The band sold out just by the by.
Jeez.
You're gonna be waitlisted.
Oh, that's crap.
All right. Yeah, I can't show that part, definitely. I mean, there's just... Okay. Yeah, so there you go. You can go to the bang... I think it's just bangfit.com if you want to... bang.fit. Is a thing that you can get, apparently.
Yeah, just don't go to Pornhub directly, because that's
what I actually like. Right out the back.
You don't want to see what's happening on our browser.
No.
Well, because I clicked the link in the...
I did! I thought I was going to take it.
I thought it was going to take you to something else.
Nope.
And that's why we don't live show. Actually, I can't.
That's why you never want to see what's... You have no idea what's happening.
The front of the website at bang.fit. Actually, I love the 80s style that's going on here. And there's that same video we saw. let's see. How deep can I get down the rabbit hole? So what it does do, what it does actually.
We're not even the dirty ones today. It's all you, buddy.
So, all right. I
welcome. What happened in LA?
I did.
They changed you, didn't they?
Yes, apparently. It is interesting, though, because I did investigate a little bit. I did listen, it was a week by myself, okay? But what?
You're turning red.
But it's interesting because you go to the website and it actually has you go up to the mobile version to ask you how many players are involved. And there's like gives a code in it and it actually does sync with your phone, it looks like. And then I can't show you anymore. but everything is, I can tell you everything is fitness themed. So amazing. There was actually one called kettlebells, but okay. But you can check that out on your own time and not at work at bang.fit. So thank you.
I love it. It's got a scoreboard. This makes me so happy.
Are you getting
Why are your
into
initials
it?
On there?
Wait, really? I was like, what? Did I do that?
I was looking for reviews in the group. So,
and it's amazing because only one of them could be, you know, kind of dirty. Like none of these are actual. Well, that might be two. There's a couple of them, but most of them are actual people's initials. I love it. Can I learn more about them? Do they have a profile? Oh, no, there's nothing to
Is
click.
Is this going
to
be at LFG?
Do you really want to meet these people?
Yes. I mean, I'm looking at these sexercises and wondering who in the world can do these all.
Somebody
well, pointed, I don't know how they have the calorie pointed. Breakout by male and female.
I don't. John Carman was on our Facebook. He says he really enjoyed the uni split jerk.
Uni split jerk. Let's see what that one is.
Well, for Awesome Cast After Dark, we'll be looking into that one.
I don't think that's a real one. I think he just maybe that's something he practices.
Katie Dudas.
Hi.
Dutters. At K Dutters on
Cutters,
the Twitter.
On Cutters.
At Cutters on the Twitter. At K Dutters. Do we find out who that actually was?
Nobody.
She's on the Scare House podcast, scarehouse.com. Ooh, a lot of fun stuff. She's sometimes she's zombie. What was it? Alice in Wonderland you guys did a few weeks ago?
Wizard of Oz.
Yeah,
I was Glinda, the good witch zombie.
For the pinball, you can check that out. Also, Thursday videos at Scarehouse as well.
Yes, we're always doing
Cutters. Cutters is a level one CrossFit trainer.
Oh, see? That's obviously me.
Is Cutters on BangFit?
That I do not know.
Yeah, please tweet at Cutters and ask him if he's at BangFit.com.
John Chichilla, who me. I'm sure will have an article about Bang.fit very soon at ChillaTech.net.
I don't know if I'll be covering that, but we'll definitely be doing video on the VR side.
Yo, it's so too bad. You know, it's too bad we didn't put the 360 camera behind your monitors over there to get what really happens during the show. That might be just another version that we do somewhere down the line. So,
what would be interesting too is if you could kind of get two of these and actually move to different vantage points in the room as if you were
go.
Standing in different
there you
locations.
Go. That could be good. You can kind of self switch it or something like that. I wonder if there's a stream option with this, like there is with the Ricoh Theta. Kind of like, can we tack that? Can we plug this thing into a Wirecast and do something with it?
That,
I'm kind of curious.
I don't think so at this point in time. But
I will
try to figure that out.
Well, this is also, like I said, this is pre-release, so not everybody's got their hands on it to hack the thing. Mm-hmm. Like the Ricoh Theta thing was kind of a surprise deal that you could do that over USB. Mm-hmm. So, all right. On that point, and of course, I'm at Sorgatron on the Twitter. Wait, I'm Mike Sorgatron on the Twitter. My name is not actually Sorgatron. I did that wrong.
You can find him on
check everything at awesomecast.net. A lot of great stuff. We got a lot of interviews coming up. We just got a couple in the can. You can check out the live recording of it with the mess ups and everything over at AwesomeCast on the Facebook with Go Jane Go and Project Impact, two groups that were finalists in the Startup Women's Edition Startup Weekend, and so much other great things going on. If you're in the Pittsburgh area next Thursday, I believe that is technically June 2nd, we will be at looking for group for the 6-year anniversary special edition. Come out, play some video games with us. They do have the Vive and the Oculus Rift. So go in I think we're going to do the show like around 7 o'clock, and then I'm going to hang out and put a couple bucks down and play some games with anybody who wants to stick around as well. So look for the Facebook group. I'm sorry, the Facebook page event, and let us know you're coming and everything for that. And we're going to be using, because Looking for Group has their own studio set up. I'm very excited to check out. They've been doing a lot of fun stuff. So follow them on Twitch and see what they've been doing as well. So thank you, everybody. Thank you to our chat room, live.sorgatronmedia.com. Tragar, Wheels have been in there. Juggalo John, Mad Mike, Riz, Getting Ready, of course. And Jedi Master Chilla, of course. I love that name. Eamon as well. Thank you, everybody, for hanging out with us and joining us. We'll see you guys next week. Thank you to our awesome chat room. You're our awesome audience. Have an awesome week. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com.